Hey YouTube, following off the last Art of War episode where we looked on what the war roster meta was, I actually thought there'd be a second part to that video because whilst we explained a lot about what a IGVG, how many IGVGs you take, how many mediums and heavy you take, I didn't explain what each kind of role would take. You know, is a bruiser taking 300 con or 300 strength? Are people running 50 decks? What are kind of, you know, the key perks that people are running? So really this is a two-parter off the back of the last episode. Because the recording's already at 30 minutes, I haven't included a VOD review section at this time just to try to trim the video down a little bit. We'll include a VOD review section next time. If you want to get your VOD reviewed by me for the next episode, please let me know in the comment section below. We'll jump into my Discord. And as always, look, the likes and subscribes in the last couple of weeks has been fantastic on the channel. I'd really, really like to get to 4K by the end of the month. So if you could drop me a subscribe on this video, if you enjoy the content, it'd be massively appreciated. And of course, I do stream the game regularly. You can find my Twitch channel link in the description below. Let's get into this week's video. We're going to break this down, this video, this Art of War episode 3, into looking at the particular classes and what perks they're running, because I mentioned single target heal, but I didn't tell you what perks single target healers are running, what their loadout typically looks like. Same for bruisers, heavy bruisers, BBIG, DPS support, etc. We're going to look at each of those in kind, and we're going to take a look at what they're running and what perks they're running. And I've got the Twitch chat with me now. They're going to be able to chime in if they think I've got something wrong. But I think it's important as a follow-up, because I've told you that some players run 300 con heavy or medium or heavy or light, but I haven't told you what their point system are, what their how their perks are allocated. So I think that's important to tell you. So let's look at healers in the first instance. I really want to focus on healers. So there's two kind of healers, and I mentioned this in the last video. You get either single target healers or AoE healers. Now, an AoE healer means pure AoE healing, and I mentioned that in the last video, but single target healer doesn't mean they're running full single target. It just means they're running at least one single target. Perhaps they're running two single target if they're healing the assassin group, and that's because the assassin group won't play as a five-man clump. They'll be dispersed, and so having those single target heals will give them more effective healing. The single target healers are running Divine Embrace. No one runs Light's Embrace. Every healer on the server that I know is running Divine Embrace. And as part of that, they're running Refreshing Divining Brace as their weapon perk, and they're running that on their life staff. And you can actually farm a really good life staff with Blessed and Refreshing Divining Brace and a third perk called Glowing Life Crystal, I think it is, and that's available from Dynasty. And you need to run M1 to M5 Dynasty to have the maximum chance of it dropping, I think. But basically, all the healers are running the Glowing Life Crystal just to get Refreshing Divining Brace. And the thing with Refreshing Divining Brace is basically when they're target is less than 50% HP, you almost get practically full cooldown. So you can effectively spam Divine Embrace. Now, Divine Embrace does have a bit of a cast time. It's got a 1 second animation, but people are running it because of the chain effect that Divine Embrace can have. Now, because of that refreshing impact on the life staff, people understand that they can spam and spam and spam. Now, that makes healer positioning super important because you don't want to get interrupted. But they are basically all running Glowing Life Crystal. I know some people try to make a case for running Fortifying Sacred Ground on the weapon, but and some healers maybe do if they've got Abyss Fortifying Sacred Ground life staff. They probably are running that. And that's really good. But the weapon perks you need to run are Refreshing Divine Embrace, Fortifying Sacred Ground, and then people are running either Beacon or Splash. And then you're talking about what a healer should run in terms of Constitution. I'm a big believer that healers should probably run 200 con. And the healer community are probably going to lambast me for that. But I always go back to a guy called Gatos. Gatos used to be a healer in a company I was in called Trauma. And Fury Gatos was in as well. Gatos has been with me for a little bit. I don't think he plays the game anymore. I've not seen him for a while. But I remember Gatos doing 3.3 million healing as a 200 con healer. So if any healer tells me I can't run 300 con, it's going to affect my damage numbers too much, I just don't believe you. Because I've seen this guy running 5 resilient, 200 con, 3.3 million heal. With single target healing, by the way. He was running Divine Embrace. He wasn't running full AoE healer. So I know it can work. You need to be a good player to make it work. Don't get me wrong. But I think the reason you need to run a minimum 150 con, you shouldn't go less than 150 con. So you should be running as a healer 5 resilient. And after your 5 resilient, you should be running 5 refreshing. Not shirking fortifying or anything like that. You need 100% uptime on your abilities. You need refreshing or refreshing evasion. I think the healer community has moved towards refreshing. I don't really know why, because I know that if you have maximum refreshing evasion, it's still better than refreshing. But perhaps because refreshing gives you the cooldown reduction on your primary and your secondary rather than just your equipped weapon. Maybe that's what they're thinking. But basically, 5 refresh and 5 resilient is optimal. You can talk about elemental, you can talk about physical versions, those kind of versions, shuriken, foot of fire. No, refresh and resilient is the way to go with the armor perks. It's basically the way to go. And then you obviously need blessed on your ring. Anyway, that's healers. And then I want to talk about bruisers and what bruisers are running. So if you look at bruisers, I mean, this is a typical Mauler's Fury tree. Look, whether a bruiser should run Bloodlust or Maulers, I've heard compelling cases for both. I know really good bruisers who run Maulers, and I know really good bruisers who run Bloodlust. In reality, both are excellent choices. To me, on paper, as a Fury crafter and not a bruiser main, I think both are excellent choices. The passives on Mauler's Fury are better than the passives on Bloodlust, but the Bloodlust movement speed and the 15% empower is just nice to have as a... Yeah, because you basically have it with 100% uptime, whereas Maulers will require you to get this. And there's a very specific way to proc Maulers when you're, you know, throwing your gravel and getting an attack and trying to shockwave and getting back to your maelstrom that, you know, there's a very specific way to proc Maulers on that way. So with that in mind, you know, whether you're running Bloodlust or Maulers, there's only 4 perks you're choosing from as a bruiser. You're always choosing Gravwell, and that's because every single war scenario on this game focuses on a Gravwell. It's the center of every army strategy. So if you're not running Gravwell, you are absolutely memeing, and you should be running... You could make a point for not running Unyielding, to be fair. You could take another passive, but Gravity Well with Crowded Well, yes. Then you probably want to be running Maelstrom because this is just nice burst damage. Then, to me, you have a couple of choices. In fact, you could run... There's five perks you could pick from, 5 abilities you could pick from. Don't choose Execute. It's getting buffed in the next patch, but in the current patch, hell no. In fact, this is a... I don't like Reap. This was an Arena build. If you're running Arena, you can run Reap. In War, I wouldn't recommend it, personally. If you're running Bloodlust... Look, if you're a medium bruiser roaming, you can make a very, very strong case to take Reap. A really strong case to take Reap on a Bloodlust medium bruiser build. That being said, you're going to have to drop something because I always think you need one of 2 movement abilities. You either need Charge or you need Whirlwind. I actually think that heavies can run Whirlwind and medium should be running Charge. Charge is a better movement ability than Whirlwind. Whether you run Fortifying Whirlwind or not depends on whether you're heavy or not. And again, it depends on whether you're on Whirlwind or not. But do you run Refreshing Charge? I don't think Refreshing Charge is ultimately needed. Enfeebling Maelstrom. Do you need Enfeebling Maelstrom? I think it's nice to have, but the question is, what do you drop Enfeebling Maelstrom for? Because you're going to have to drop a Resilient or a Shuriken Fortify, probably, or an Elemental Aversion, or a Refreshing Ward. Arguably, all of those things are a little bit better than the weaken you get from Maelstrom, but I do really like as a combination, if you could get it, and there's not that many of these around, Refreshing Move, Thwarting Strikes, Enfeebling Maelstrom, all on the Great Axe, because I think then, when you get it on the Great Axe, it's like a 24% reduction in strength, so 24% weaken, and that is pretty significant impact right there. So I actually really like that. You're just going to run it on your armor. I don't think the case is as compelling personally. I think it's good, but most of the bruiser community doesn't quite like it. I'm not 100% sure, but if you maelstrom a target and your friend did that after you, he will overwrite your enfeebling. Oh, so if you have the 24% and they have a 14%, they'll overwrite it? That would need to be tested. Yeah, that would need to be tested. So those are all of the abilities. As I say, you can make a case for Maulers and Bloodlust. I think the accepted bruiser community tends to run Maulers on heavy and Bloodlust on mediums. Tends to. But I do know medium bruisers who run Maulers. I don't know heavy bruisers that run Bloodlust. But I do know mediums that run Maulers. So I don't think either of those are too bad. But I got to say, on your Great Axe, every single bruiser in a high-end PvP competitive company is running Refreshing Move and Thwarting Strikes. And they're just running 2 perkers. They're not running legendaries because to get a legendary with Refreshing Move and Thwarting Strikes and a good 3rd perk is insanely expensive. But every single bruiser playing war at the high-end PvP level is running Refreshing Move, Thwarting Strikes across every single company without question. And why are they doing that? Well, they're doing that because Thwarting Strikes gives you an 11 or 12% when you 625 it increase to damage when you have grit. And if you have 300 strength, you have grit on light and heavy attacks. Now, all bruisers, medium and heavy, are running 300 strength, 200 con, because they're all getting grit, and the 200 con is enough to get rid of the crit, to get for the extra resilient on the crit damage. So everyone should be running Thwarting Strikes. Now, Thwarting Strikes gives you that 12% uplift when you have grit. What abilities have grit? I think the only ability that has grit on the Great Axe is the second spin of Maelstrom. If we read it here, Maelstrom does an extra spin and it gains grit. on the startup of this second spin. So you get the extra damage on the second spin of Maelstrom, but not on the first. You don't get it on anything else. I don't think any of these other abilities have grit. Oh, charge has grit. You get it on grit. You get it on charge, but it's not much, right? Nothing else has grit. Whirlwind has grit. You get it on Whirlwind as well. There you go. So quite a few abilities, actually. Now, if you can't afford a refreshing move for Thing Strikes Grey Axe, that's probably going to set you back about 70k, at least on most servers I've seen. You could go for a cheap option, which is Enchanted. Refreshing move. But why? So you'll notice the key combination is refreshing move is the common factor. And the common factor is because as a bruiser, you're going to be standing there with your swings, hitting a lot of targets at once normally because you're involved in a clump battle. So your swing can take like 10% off your cooldowns. And you want as much uptime on Gravity Well as you could possibly get because it is the single best ability in the entire game offensively. So everyone's running refresher move. Around that, you could run Attunement is a good perk, Shirking's a good perk, there's lots of other good perks, but really the two you need to focus on are Refresher Move Forting, and that's what 90% of the bruiser community probably using still to this day. You should have Insatiable Gravity Well on your armor for the heal. Do you need Refreshing Charge? I doubt it. Do you need Fortifying Whirlwind? Probably quite nice. Do you need Enfeebling Maelstrom? Good on your Grax, not so great on your armor, personally. Crippling Reap? Yes, Crippling Reap is actually quite good. If you're playing a medium bruiser chasing, like on an off point chasing a healer, Crippling Reap is quite nice to have, I would say. Again, nice on your Grax if you're playing that kind of role. Depends on the role you're playing as to what you take. And then it's 300 strength, 200 con. Now, if we look at the Warhammer, this is probably a standard Warhammer build for a medium and heavy bruiser. If you're heavy, you can make a case for running Armor Breaker. I think you can make a case because it's quite a nice burst damage. If you're running medium, I think you've got to take Wrecking Ball. For me, this is what I used to recommend. When I was running Fury, I used to tell my heavies they could run Armor Breaker for the additional rend, and my mediums had to run Wrecking Ball. And the reason why mediums had to run Wrecking Ball is because they got Fortify on that for 7 seconds, 20%, which is huge. So as a medium, you want that bit more Fortify. Heavies didn't need that Fortify because they had the armor, so they could take Armor Breaker for the additional rend. That's what I did. Then you want to take Shockwave. Everyone takes Shockwave. There's no reason why you shouldn't. And Half of Destiny. No one runs Mighty Gavel because Mighty Gavel doesn't have grit. And no one runs Clear Up because it's a bit of a meme. And this is the kind of tree I would typically recommend. Now, in terms of armor perks, well, in terms of hammers, a good starting hammer used to be Blackguard's Warhammer because it had Vaulting Strikes on it. But now, people are starting to move away from that. People are starting to put Sundering Shockwave on their hammer. And that's because of the rend that Sundering Shockwave gives you. So on the hammer, it gives you... I'll put the image on the screen for exactly how much it gives you. But that additional rend is really nice. Rend obviously increases the damage that the enemies will take, and you're going to be shockwaving a lot. So most bruisers are running Sundering Shockwave on their hammer. Can you make a case for not running it on your hammer? Yes, you could, but then you should definitely be running it on your armor because it forms part of the rend stacks that all of the top-end PvP companies are using. The top-end PvP companies are thinking, how do we get people to rend cap? And part of that is Shockwave. So yes, you should be running it. Then Path of Destiny. Now, are people running Leeching Path of Destiny? It's not as good as people make out for me. And that's because already with Prevailing Spirit, 35% of your damage dealt with a Crowd Crush ability, which anything on the right tree, will heal you. 35% of damage dealt. So that means Path of Destiny already heals you for a lot. So do you need the additional 28% from Leeching Path of Destiny? Yeah, I suppose if you've got Abyss Piece, you might as well run it, but I wouldn't go out of my way to get it. Would I drop a Shirking Fortify for it or something like that? Not entirely sure. It's nice, but it's not essential. The essential piece is Sundering Shockwave. Do you need Penetrating Wrecking Ball? No, you don't need Penetrating Wrecking Ball. The Armor Bypass is better on heavies than it is on mediums. It depends on where you're playing. If you're a medium playing off point, I definitely wouldn't think you need it. If you're a heavy playing on point, you can make a case. But the damage upgrade is so small, I wouldn't really think it's that good, to be honest with you. And then what are they running on the rest of their hammers? Shirking, any Shirking move is really good because on the hammer, procs on abilities, which is really nice for that additional damage. Thwarting Strikes, yes, but you could also kind of make a case for Thwarting Counter, which is you deal 20% damage against players of active grit. So if you're going up against bruisers a lot, you can actually do some nice, decent damage with Thwarting Counter. But I would say really, you know, the accepted kind of bis is Thwarting Strikes, Sundering Shockwave, and then a Shirking ability. Is most of bruisers running 300 strength, 200 comp. Now the thing I want to focus on is the support players, the IGVGs, who are going to be the support backbone of the army. What are IGVGs running? Okay, so as a support player, VGIG, wherever you run 300 con or 300 in is purely dependent upon your armor and whether you're medium or heavy. Now, when do you run medium and when do you run heavy? Well, when I was doing rosters, I would always tell my point players they should be 300 con heavy. When they were off-point players supporting their bruiser group, they should probably be medium 300 in. Now, why is that? I think when you play as a five-man off-point, sometimes you can lack damage to do big bursts, and so you need that bit of damage. Now, the thing with 300 in is, oh, yes, you'll get the more damage just from it, and you'll get more damage from medium, but you'll also get the benefit of the 30% duration to Ice Storm and to Oblivion, which is really nice if you have to stand in it. Which, when you're playing on point, you obviously want heavy armor for every point player. And then at that point, you just want to cause as much root and slow as possible. And that's the benefit of having 300 con to give you that uplift. You definitely, it's either 300 con heavy, or 300 in medium, 300 con heavy. Now, what does the builds look like? Well, you can see the build video on my channel for my IGVG medium and heavy spec. I'll put the card in the description on the top right of your screen now. That'll show you what I think for IGVG, but it will change next patch a little bit. But let me just look at the trees. The reason I run this tree is because cleansing potion is so strong, you don't need the cleansing too. Next patch, you will. But right now, you don't need that because you can spam cleansing potion every 8 seconds. So what's the point in having another cleanse potion every 30 seconds? It doesn't make much sense to me to take that. This would be lovely to take. I would like the increased fortify when I break out of Entomb, but I take this on Defiant Freeze anyway. And if you break out quickly, you still proc it. If not, okay, well, fine. You choose when to come out anyway. Then what armor perks do you have to take? The accepted BIS amongst the IGVG community for a long time was Crystalline Curse. Now, why was it Crystalline Curse? Crystalline Curse is great because one, it's refreshing move and you want as much uptime in these abilities as you can because you're a support player. So you want to be throwing Storm and Shower as much as you possibly can. Refreshing move helps you to get there. Then you're throwing out a lot of left clicks. So Enchanted's just nice because it's just a 10% damage uplift on your left clicks. Lovely. And then you have Unending Thaw. Now, Unending Thaw is great because when someone leaves your Ice Storm for two, and you have up to 2 seconds to apply a heavy attack route to them. When I say heavy attack route, I mean heavy freeze. This is what, when you watch my stream and I say heavy attack route, what I mean is I'm proccing heavy freeze because I'm basically, they hit the Ice Storm and they've left or they're still in it and I heavy attack them, I will root them for 1 second. You can't chain it because it's got a 4 second cooldown, but it is nice just to buy your bruiser group time to catch them. So you definitely want that to give yourself more chance to get heavy freeze. Now, Ice Storm or the Ice Storm perk, Unending Thaw, also increases Ice Storm damage, which is just quite nice. Other perks, do you run Healing Tomb? No, I have a BIS Healing Tomb piece. I have Healing Tomb, Refreshing, Resilient. I dropped it because Healing Tomb, since the last patch, they nerfed this, and it's now, Healing Tomb now provides about 1100. It's about the same as a mana potion healing on base, because it scales off base HP. When you read Healing Tomb, it says this is something percentage of base HP. What's your base HP? It's 5 con. It's nuts. If you have 500 con, 300 con, 100 con, you get the same heal now on Healing Tomb, which wasn't the case before. So in my IGVG guide, I said you could run 500 con and get a load of self-heal of Healing Tomb. That's no longer. Do you need to run Deadly Frost? The old community on IGVG would say, no, you don't need to run Deadly Frost. All Deadly Frost used to do was provide a 10% per second dot on Ice Shower. They're not really needed too much. Bit of pad damage. Now Deadly Frost reduces the cooldown. And if it's on your void, if it's on your Ice Gauntlet, it reduces the cooldown by 3 seconds. And if it's on your arm, it reduces the cooldown by 2 seconds. Is that enough to worry about? I kind of think it is. At the beginning when it first came, I've only just recently picked this up. I didn't think it was that good. Someone in the company had a conversation with me about it and convinced me that it is quite good. If your job on war is to spam shower on the gates, then you want maximum uptime on your shower. Yes, you should pick up Deadly Frost and it should be on your Ice Gauntlet. If you're a medium player off point, just maybe put it on your armor. If you put it on your armor, you're probably going to replace a refreshing on your armor, which case it provides you a bit better, but it only provides it just on one ability rather than across 5 other abilities, because refreshing will, of course, benefit your Void Gauntlet and your 2 other Ice Gauntlet abilities. So you can make a case for it and not for it. But I do like Deadly Frost as a heavy 300 con player. I think Deadly Frost on the Ice Gauntlet is quite good. Then we'll look at Void Gauntlet. What Void Gauntlet perks do you have to run? Every single Void Gauntlet player on this entire game should be running Putrefying Scream on your Void Gauntlet. Putrefying Scream will do a 40% disease on a target. The disease cap is 50%, meaning that you are basically almost capping disease in one ability. And rooting. I don't know of anyone, unless you're a light IGVG, who shouldn't be running Scream on their Void Gauntlet. If you're a light IGVG, maybe you run Orb. You're spamming Orb so much, perhaps. But to anyone else, mediums and heavy should be running Scream, without question. Then you have to have Nullifying Oblivion. You must have Nullifying Oblivion. It's the single best defensive ability on the game to remove all of the enemy buffs. And you also must, and whether diminishing orb is a must have or not, look, diminishing orb is not a must have. It's better on medium than it is on heavy, but I don't actually run diminishing orb because I had to drop it. The reason why diminishing orb isn't that good, look, if you're a point player, you definitely don't need diminishing orb, because on point you're just going to be dropping oblivion so often that all diminishing orb dub is like a, it's like a ranged oblivion. So for a medium could make a case for it, but heavy can't. So I don't think diminishing orb is critical, and I know a ton of IGVGs who don't run diminishing orb. It's nice to have, not a must have. That's what the support players are running. And I want to look at BBIG next, because BBIG is a significant player base. A lot of point players are BBIG, and some are BBIG light. All point players are BBIG heavy. What are BBIGs running? Well, they're definitely running Unending 4. They could make a case for Deadly Frost as well. They don't need Healing Tomb. They're probably running this tree, to be brutally honest with you. That's what BBIG heavy is running. In terms of the blunderbuss, what are they running? They're probably running a skill tree. It doesn't look too dissimilar to this, but what about weapon perks? A BBIG heavy on point should be running Plague Splitting Nades. I think I have one. I mean, what most people run if they're just getting into it is Tainted Metal. You can farm this thing. It's got Plague Crits and Plague Splitting Nades. I have another blunderbuss somewhere, I think, with Plague Splitting Nades somewhere else. But the reason is, again, a 24% disease across the point is really nice. So yes, blunderbuss are running Plague Splitting Nades on their blunderbuss. And then what about something else? Are they running Exhaustive Net Shot? It's nice to have, but it's not necessary. Are they running Leeching Shrapnel Blast? It's nice to have, it's not necessary. Best thing you can do with your blunderbuss is full resilient Shirking Fortification. Plague Splitting Nades, yes. These two, nice to have. No one's playing Mortar. Some people play Claw Shot. Empowered Claw Shot's difficult because it's on a 10 meter distance, which is quite hard to proc. But if you can make it work, it's nice. Some people run Blast Shot, but it doesn't work against enemies of grit. So this ain't going to really work against bruisers. It just works as like an arena thing. So I wouldn't recommend it in a war scenario too much. This is probably the build. As a lighter player, you probably, you're going to be less focused on just pure tankiness and probably taking a damage perk. Maybe you take ramp or something like that. The claw shot's more for assassin. Although this is the standard assassin build, but I do know like Chronic and stuff obviously runs claw shot. But I still know a lot of assassins who just run net. So you can make a case for it. But light's probably playing not too dissimilar, just lighter gear. If you're running light, then you just want pure damage. So you want enchanted, keenly empowered blunderbuss, preferably with shirking or mortal power. I don't think Plague Splitting Nades as a light player is necessary because you're not going to be spamming on point. You're just going to be assassinating. So you just want pure damage. Same if you're running light IG blunderbuss. You probably don't need Crystalline Curse. You probably want something like Keen Vicious, Keenly Empowered Ice Gauntlet for max damage. Then on Rapier, they're definitely running Sundering Shockwave. The tree will look something like this because they're probably running Riposte and Flesh. And they probably only need to run Sundering Shockwave. Omnidirectional Evade on your Rapier is great. But I think it's 18% in power when you evade. So when you just spam in left click, that's really nice. Just quick and power. It probably looks something like that. That's quite an easy one. Musket. What skill perks are you looking at on Musket? You're looking at... I've got a Musket Guide video. I can't link the card. I've linked one earlier, but you can find it in my playlists. Empowered Shooter Stance, but on your armor, not on your weapon, because you'll hit the Empower Cap too quickly. Mortal Empowerment on your ring, first and foremost. You don't need Mending Sticky Bombs. You do want Crippling Powder Burn. Same for Rapier. Then Spear Hatchet. Spear Hatchet players, and again, Musket players are running 50 con, 300 dex, 150 in. Spear Hatchet players, this is my PvE spear build, they're running Berserk, and they're using it quite defensively. So when they get less than 50% health and they're getting targeted, then they'll run that Berserk to cleanse themselves. Really nice. A lot of them are running Feral Rush for the root. And then these throw, this because it's got buffed in the last patch, they're running this. But I think most assassins who are running Hatchet are probably running something like 150 con, 100 con, I think. And then they're combining that with the spear. And on the spear, everyone seems to be running sweep nowadays. No one runs Volt Kick anymore. So they tend to run Perforate, Sweep, and Javelin. And the reason for Javelin is one for the range, one for the knockdown. Obviously, Sweep for the knockdown, a way to zone their targets. And then Perforate is actually quite nice DPS with the Fortify. Less so Skewer, no one runs Volt Kick anymore. What weapon perks do you want? Sundering Javelin, yes, really nice. You don't need Coup de Grace, Bleeding Sweep, I don't think. That's not essential. Fortify and Perforate, yes. Really nice on your spear. But if you want the damage, then obviously you can do Sundering Javelin on your spear as well. In terms of Hatchet perks, Keen Berserk is not that needed. The reason why Keen Berserk is not needed, it's got a lot of crit chance anyway. I think it's a Crippling Feral Rush. Is it Crippling Feral Rush? I think. But I think most people on the hatchet are kind of just running Vicious Rogue or a combination of, you know, as much damage as you can, maybe Penetrating Strikes to bypass armor, and then something like Keenly Empowered. But it's maximum damage. Firestaff users are all running Fireball. Everyone wants Fireball. Why do people want Fireball? Fireball got buffed hugely when empowering when Fireball could then crit. And with Fireball being able to crit, that's so much burst damage, it's insane. And so for that reason, everyone is running Empowering Fireball, which does more damage when you get hit by Fireball. And they're running it on the Firestaff because it's something like 50% additional damage. This is one of the best burst abilities in the game. You can farm Wildfire Torch in OPR, which has Enchanted, Empowering Fireball, Keenly Empowered. It's close to Biss. I think Biss is swapping out Enchanted for Vicious, because then Vicious gives you more crit damage on the Fireball. It's even more burst, and burst is the king on this. But they're running this. They're all running Rune of Helios. All running Rune of Helios because Rune of Helios is just a nice empower ability. And then you can make a case for two different things. You can run a case for Pillar of Fire or Flamethrower. I think Pillar of Fire is better. And I think the better players use Pillar of Fire. And the reason is you can spam it, because refreshing Pillar of Fire, if you have that, is so good. Basically give you a, like, quite high cooldown reduction on this ability, so you can spam Pillar of Fire almost constantly, and it's amazing burst. Flamethrower is a really good pressure ability. So if you're on an enemy healer and you're flaming them, they will stop healing and they will run. No one really stands in the Flamethrower because you start building up these stacks. So that pressure is highly, highly valuable. I guess it depends on what your role is. Is your role one of these DPS players? If your role is one of these DPS players, I wouldn't recommend Flamethrower because you're not going to be pressuring single targets. You're going to be hitting the clump. So your bruiser group throws a grav and everyone jumps in. You should be on the sidelines spamming your abilities on that clump, supporting your group. Pillar of Fire would do a better job on that. If you're maybe playing as more of an assassin player, Flamethrower is a really good option for you. And definitely Burnout. You need a defensive ability to get away, and Burnout is that. And obviously for the mana recovery as well. But yeah, I would say Empowering Fireball, Refreshing Pillar of Fire. Do you need the Burnout option that gives you more mana? I wouldn't say so, no. You could probably just Mana Pot. And then Ice Gauntlet build again looks like this, and they're running Unending 4. Maybe running Deadly Frost, probably not. Definitely Unending 4. And light players will be running Spike, so they will want Iced Refresh. Iced Refresh basically gives you cooldown reduction on your Ice Gauntlet abilities when you get a kill with Spike. The best light IG Firestaffs are running Spike, and they're really dangerous with it. So yeah, Ice Refresh. You can make a really good case for that on the Ice Gauntlet. I think on the Ice Gauntlet, it's something like 75% cooldown reduction. I mean, I have boots with it on. Yeah, 42% on the armor, 75% I think is on the armor, which is insane. So you can definitely make a case for Ice Reef on the Ice Gauntlet if you're playing light. What are light IG Firestaffs running? They're almost certainly running 300 in. They're probably running 350 in. 350 in, 150 con. Something like, maybe even 100 con. I'd recommend 150 con, personally, 350 in. So kind of an overview of heavy players. Heavier players will obviously have more con because that will scale off the heavier armor better. So they're probably running, if you're a bruiser, it's 200 con minimum. All heavy players are running 200 con as an absolute minimum. And if not, 300 con. Medium players are probably running 200 con and not going up to 300 con. They're probably just sat on 200 con, perhaps 150. Light players will obviously go more glass cannon. They're probably around 100 con. So muskets will be at 50 con. Bows will be at 100 to 150. Firestaff IG will be at 100 to 150 as well. Perhaps 200 even, you can make a case. Healers will be up between 150 and 200. If healers are running less than 150. And that's the end of this week's video. I hope that you enjoyed all of the content you saw here. If you did enjoy the content, please give me a like and subscribe. Drop me a Twitch follow. And if you have any VOD footage that you'd like me to review for next week's episode, please let me know in the comments section below or in my Discord, and we can get that reviewed for you as well. We can do that with or without comms. We can include particular sections or not include particular sections. It could be particularly at your freedom of choosing. If you don't want to leak any information, that's completely reasonable as well. Until next time, everyone, stay safe. Keep rocking.